गुड
हाँ, गुड इवनिंग जनरल कुलकर्णी।
इवनिंग,
गुड गुड, थैंक यू सो मच। सो आई थिंक सो वी शुड स्टार्ट नाउ।
हाउ आर यू? श्योर,
गुड इवनिंग लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन। दिस इज प्रदीप तोहोर, द प्रोग्राम डायरेक्टर फ्रॉम आदित्य बिरला एजुकेशन एकेडमी। Volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, VUCA, are the realities of today. As noted futurist and author Bob Johnson says, it won't be getting easier. Leaders must accept this reality. Uncertainty and complexity aren't going away, and confusion will remain part of the mix. Can predict the future with certainty. The school ecosystem dynamically to the emerging circumstances, and to throw some light on it, we have with us General Surendra Kulkarni, who will highlight the issues that need attention and what steps school leaders can take. Lieutenant General Kulkarni has served in the Indian Army for about 4 decades. He was commissioned into the Army Corps in 1975. In his long and distinguished career, he has commanded the largest forces and held some of the most prestigious assignments. In recognition of his special contribution, he has been awarded a Vishisht Seva Medal twice, and Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, and finally the highest peacetime Distinguished Service Award in the Armed Forces, the Param Vishisht Seva Medal, by the President of India. Parallel to his army career, he has pursued his academic interests. He is an economics graduate from Ferguson College, Pune. He was a postgraduate UGC Merit Scholar before he joined the Army. He has 4 master's degrees, including an MPhil degree. He would be one of the few officers to have been sent abroad thrice on an academic assignments. General Kulkarni is an alumnus of prestigious Mayo College, Ajmer, and is presently the director of the You, General Kulkarni.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pradeep, and thank you to the Aditya Birla Education Academy for being kind enough to invite me. I also wish to thank all the participants who have taken time out to attend this masterclass. The format for today that I propose to follow is that I will address all of you for some time. While the address is going on, I will request you to kindly place your comments or questions onto the administrator's portal, who will make note of them, and after I finish speaking, we'll throw up those questions and we will try and answer them or have a dialogue on them. Once again, I thank you very much for joining this masterclass. My topic today is school leadership in an uncertain world. Now, immediately this COVID crisis comes to mind. I would like all of you to bear in mind that this topic goes beyond that. The COVID crisis is immediate and therefore it requires crisis management. But leadership in an uncertain world requires a much longer timeline and a much further horizon to look at. So therefore, whereas COVID-19 helps us to focus our minds, at the same time, we must remember that we need to take a long-term perspective as school leaders to be able to function effectively in an uncertain world. So this topic got 3 elements if we break them down. One is the issue of the uncertain world. The second is the issue of leadership. And the third is about schools. And of course, they're interconnected, so their school leadership and the world. So every generation, every leader that has ever spoken has always mentioned that we are living in unprecedented times. These are great challenges we are facing. So we are not the first people to be talking about an uncertain world. I was going to speak to you about Yoga, but Mr. Ore has already introduced that, so I will let it pass. But there is a phenomenon known as a Black Swan event. And this was pointed out by a famous person called Nassim Nicholas Taleb, who said that a black swan event, in the good old days, in mythology, it was considered that there are no black swans, though in practice, the world has found them now. But the characteristics of a black swan are that it's a rarity and an unpredictable rarity. It has a severe impact and consequences. And most importantly, in hindsight, people say that, oh, this could have been anticipated and dealt with. To give an example, in 2005, there is a famous speech by President George Bush when he's talking about getting ready for a pandemic and in preparing ourselves to deal with it in advance. And et cetera, et cetera. 15 down the road, we all know nothing has happened. So therefore, this again today, COVID-19 is a black swan event. After some time, when we look back, we will say, oh, this could have seen, we could have tackled it differently. We knew the answers to this, et cetera, et cetera. So therefore, one of the problems is when you look at hindsight is what is known as retrospective predictability. Whereas you can't predict the future, looking back, you can always rationalize as to why things happened. Now, a good leader has to look to the future and not try and rationalize and justify what happened earlier. One of the other characteristics of a black swan event is the biases that we have individually and collectively. And you will find, for example, a lot of people feel that what is the social distancing? What is this virus? It won't affect me. And which is why you will find highly educated people violating lockdowns, etc. Now, I want to add one important point. That predicting the future is not as anticipating it. Because let me tell you, the best minds in the world have got the future wrong when they try to predict it. And I'm going to give you a series of examples. Because this is very important. These are people who are masters of the game who got it wrong. And these are, gradually as we go along, you will see these are about trends which are real today. You know, the famous Chinese philosopher Lao Tzu had said in 6th century BC that those who have knowledge don't predict. And those who predict don't have knowledge. So therefore, please remember, predictions are very dangerous. Now I'll give you some examples one by one. In 1899, Thomas Alva Edison, no less, said, fooling around with alternating current is just a waste. Nobody will ever use it. In 1911, Field Marshal Ferdinand Foch, who led the Western armies of England, France, and the Allies to victory in 1918, said in 1911, that airplanes are interesting toys, but of no military value. In 1943, Thomas Watson, chairman of IBM, no less, says, I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers. In 1966, Time magazine said, remote shopping, while entirely feasible, will flop. I think we all know the story of online shopping today. In 1977, the founder of Digital Equipment Corporation, speaking at the World Future Society meeting in Boston, says there is no reason for any individual to have a computer in his home. Few years later, Martin Cooper, inventor of the cell phone, says this in 1981, cellular phones will absolutely not replace local wire systems. Let me get you even closer. In 2005, Steve Chen, the CTO and co-founder of YouTube, says, there is just not that many videos I want to watch. Have you got the idea about how such experts, and this is down their line of work, not see ahead? But interestingly, the number of predictions and the rate at which they are going wrong are reducing in the number of years that pass, because the world is changing very fast. Therefore, this uncertain world is throwing up certain contrasts rapidly. On one end, we have globalization of the economy, of technology, of travel, even of pandemics, as we now see, of mass production. But it has also thrown up inequalities. On the other end, we have localization. We have information available at our doorstep. We have people now going in for organic farming and being careful. Even in the present pandemic, localization concept called a containment zone is essentially a localization and trying to solve problem in small pockets have an impact on the larger world. So therefore, when Walmart was to come to India, everyone said the local Kirana shop will be in trouble. Today's pandemic has shown that Walmart is going to use the Kirana shop to be the source of your delivery at your doorstep. So therefore, what was live shopping towards completely online shopping into hybrid shopping, where you order online but collect physically, all such things are materializing. And therefore, the world is changing, but changing much, much faster than we can think of. There is also a rapid shift in the medium by which this change happens. At one time, it was the water and steam power which made a difference. Then electricity came, and that made the second wave. In the third wave, computing came. Now, in the fourth wave that we are seeing, there is interconnectivity, or the Internet of Things, as they call it. And the next wave that is coming, which is known to us and evident, is data. The data will be the source of all future activity, whether commercial or otherwise. You have seen even a thing like Arogya Setu, which is a new app for your health purposes, is basically banking on data. Now, all these phenomena, data, artificial intelligence, have not come about because COVID-19 suddenly hit us a few days ago. These are all well known. They have been around for long. And leaders, in many ways, which include school leaders, may have missed a trick or two here and there, not to see these trends or studying these trends. Because in a school environment, there is no one dedicated to be studying these trends for the school. I will come to this in a little while again. But for the time being, I want to introduce one more concept, and which is the concept of entropy. Now, those of you who are into chemistry and basic studies will understand what is entropy. But entropy as a phenomenon affects organizations. And what it really means, natural way we move towards chaos, in an artificial way being out of order. Therefore, in a school environment, there is tremendous emphasis on order, which is against the laws of nature. For example, curriculum, we have streams, we have calendar, we have events laid down, we have a test schedules given, assessments, grades. We try and make everything as predictable as possible. Which classroom you go to, which section you're part of, etc. But we talk about individualized learning, and yet we standardize everything. So these are challenges and problems that are going on. Most of us today are talking about sustainable development goals. But in the year 2000, we already had the Millennium Development Goals. How many schools were working on them right since then and educating the children? So now people are talking about sustainable development goals, but where will this lead us to solving which problems? So therefore, it is important to observe trends. And it's very important that every school leadership organizes a system in which there is some people or a group of people who are watching trends and seeing how this will impact, because it will differ from school. It may differ from organization to organization. There are some school chains who have private schools all over the country. So they need to have a different solution. A standalone school needs to have a different solution.
General, I'm sorry to interrupt in between. There is a question that has come up. Can we ask on this question, or we hold it for the timing and then take it forward?
Maybe we just do it at one go towards the end. Will it be okay?
That's fine. Okay, that's all. All right.
I'll take all questions. No problem, but we can just let it so that sometimes I know what I say after this may have the answer for them, but I don't know. Let's see. So this whole business of entropy must be understood, that in a natural organization, and one of the best known management gurus, Peter Drucker, had this to say, that only three things happen naturally in an organization: friction, confusion, and underperformance. And everything else requires leadership. Now, if you a lot of people are feeling very happy that we managed this sudden breakdown during COVID-19 and we switched over to digital platforms and we started online teaching. This is crisis management. This is not leadership. This is something you have to do, nothing great about it for a good school leadership. But if you can understand that friction, confusion, and underperformance is in natural order, and then you set about creating leadership, that is where it counts. And therefore, for this, it is important for leaders to understand the difference between crisis management and long-term leadership. I'll give you, being from the military, I'll give you a fine example of how in a crisis a leader leads. He is decisive, no doubt, but I'll give you another example straight from Field Marshal Ferdinand Foch. In World War I, in the Battle of the Marne in September 1914, he was in serious trouble. So he sent a report to say, my center is giving away, my right is retreating, excellent situation, I am attacking. Because he defends, he'll lose anyway. It's like a goalkeeper in football. If you keep defending, sooner or later somebody will score. So he thought the best hope is, let's attack, something may come of it. Now that is decisive leadership, but that's in a crisis management. That is not planned leadership. In many webinars, you will hear people saying that in the military, there is a saying that no battle plan lasts the first contact. I'm afraid that's half the story. Yes, because how the enemy responds, we know. We know how we were supposed to respond. We thought the enemy would respond in a certain way, and we made a plan, and it worked that way. So what does a good planner do? He makes a plan, and then he makes many contingencies. So there's a plan B and plan C and many contingencies and you war game it, that if the enemy does this, I can do this and I do that. And therefore, there are some non-variables that you can't suddenly change. You can't suddenly double the amount of ammunition in the middle of the battlefield. You can't double the number of trucks you have in the battlefield. You can't double the number of soldiers you have in the battlefield. So your contingencies have to be based around what resources you have, and that positioning of resources has to be done in a way that if your initial plan works, good. If not, one of the contingencies will play out to your advantage. Therefore, having said that, so when you're looking at the long term, what is it that a leader should do? And I know in the school environment, we love to have easy acronyms and catchphrases and stuff like that. And we all teach the four C's and all. So coming with that, I will give you a few set of C's to think about. First, a leader must create a vision. Then he has to articulate it, of course, which means he has to communicate the vision. Third, he has to create a durable optimism. If it appears that the leader does not believe in the vision, why would the rest of the organization believe in it? Next, you got to create a culture in the school that reflects this vision. You cannot just give a diktat. Your culture is as strong as the weakest link in your organization. A good leader must learn to compromise his ego. You can learn from everyone, from the highest organizations you can learn. The moment you feel that you know everything and there is nothing more to learn, that's the end of your learning and it's the beginning of the fall of your organization. You must complement competence. Those who are competent must be made work beyond their competence. The phrase I normally like to use is to move beyond excellence, and striving towards excellence should not be just a goal. And finally, the last C, most important job for a leader, is to create more leaders, not mere followers. Now, all this is easier said than done, but these are very important things that matter in a school environment. Now, essentially, what does a school have to provide? It has to provide four facets to a child, academics, and which is now being transmitted through online learning, etc. Character building, which can also be partly done online and offline. Then there are co-curricular activities, and then there are sports. If you only focus on academics, it's only schooling. If you focus on all four, that's education. So none of the students, if you ask your alumni, your best of your alumni, you ask them what was the title of a chapter in so-and-so class in so-and-so subject, nobody will remember. But they will remember the activities they did. They will remember the teachers they worked with. And therefore, that is the lifelong education. Therefore, if this is so, that these four elements have to be combined, academics, character building, co-curricular activities, and sports, then the central person in this for whom it's happening is the student. Now, we all talk about personalized learning, but we deliver mass learning. If you deliver mass learning, you will produce clones of each other. You want each student to be a unique entity, a unique identity. And therefore, there are a few elements that must be thought of by putting the student in the center. The teacher is very important. The teacher must be there. Technology today is a great tool. The technology must be there. And the third is what we in our school call the campus, but others may call it the environment. The ability to interact with the environment outside, whether it comes in the form of experiential learning, whether it becomes in the form of travel, competitions, etc. But two of the platforms during COVID are in place, the teacher and the technology. It's the third that is missing. And therefore, there are a lot of people who are trying to extrapolate, predict the future and saying that will this be the norm, that there will be only online learning in the future. Please understand, you can manage some degree of schooling through online stuff. You cannot manage education unless you come face to face and you interact with people. So therefore, in a nutshell, I want to just highlight a few points about good leadership. And I gave you so many C's, but I will summarize and recap what I had to say about five A's. The first is to anticipate. The most important quality that a leader can have is to anticipate. The second important quality is to be able to articulate. You've got to articulate what you've anticipated, because you have to get the crowd on board. Unless you get them on board, you're going nowhere all by yourself. The third is you've got to make your organization culture to come in line, and therefore you need to be agile. Often we tell ourselves everything is running smoothly, touch it. No. Today, everything is running smoothly. Tomorrow, because the world is changing around us, what is good for today and what is relevant for today will not be relevant for tomorrow. And therefore, we need to change. And therefore, the organizations have to be light. the bigger the organizations, the more the challenge is this agility. And therefore, not only you have to be willing to change and think quick on your feet, you've got to do it very fast. And if you have anticipation and articulation in place, this becomes that much easier. Finally, is the issue of adaptability. And in fact, I'm often asked, okay, sir, what is the one quality you want your students to leave school with? And I always tell them, adaptability. That because the future is unknown, we need to give them the tools which will make them adaptable to any set of circumstances that they are thrown into. So adaptability is central to the concept of providing good school education. You can get good grades, you can get admission into fancy universities. You will find many industries which tell you that their fresh graduates, even management graduates, are not fit for the job they are trained. But if you can send out adaptable children from school, you would have done a great favor to them. And the last point is you've got to act on it. A lot of us fail to walk the talk. We all know we have to do this. You have to act on it. Everybody knew Google, Microsoft in India for a long time. Everybody knew this technology is available. Why did suddenly so many people wake up to the need for it when COVID-19 hit us? Those schools who saw the need and learned the technology or the use of technology earlier found the transition so much easier and simpler. So again, I'll write you in summary to remember these five things: anticipation, articulation, agility, adaptability, and action. If these five things fall into place in your organization, then I think your school leadership would be able to a large degree to handle the uncertain world. So thank you very much with my opening remarks. And Mr. Hore, we have to take on any questions that comes now. And
one of the questions, since you were talking about entropy just now, someone has requested if you could explain entropy in a little more detail.
Okay. All right. Entropy is a phenomenon in which naturally things fall out of sequence, out of gear. This is the law of nature. Go into chemistry itself, from where the term starts, find all the particles that are moving around at random, but there's a pattern in that. We need to provide energy to put it into place. I'll give you the simplest example of entropy. If whoever has asked this question has got young children at home, if you set their cupboard nicely and come and have a look after 3 days, will you find it in the same order or will you use it in chaos? So the natural order is that there will be entropy. Then energy has to be put in to again pick up the clothes, fold them, put them systematically, put them back. So it requires intervention. Otherwise, in the natural course of events, you will lapse into entropy. And when you lapse into entropy, you have situations where you have inefficiencies, you have unnecessary friction in the system, and it results in underperformance. The interventions that you make to bring about order out of this entropy is leadership. Now, when I say order, it doesn't mean that you put up systems that don't allow disorder. Certain things can happen best in disorder. All creativity and artistic activity can only happen when there is disorder. If everybody paints the sky with the same drawing is common to all 30 students of yours or 60 students of yours, there's something wrong with your art class. But the discipline behind it, of releasing the energy to allow them to be able to draw in a certain manner, is the control over entropy that you are exercising. Next, please.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, with a prolonged period of schools remaining closed, there is a likelihood of non-payment of salaries of faculty and staff, and also layoffs, especially schools with lesser corpus and some with poor management. What policy enunciations must the government and board govern schools enforce to ensure sustainability of schools and ensuring no job cuts and pay cuts?
Yeah, This is outside the scope of my talk. Today, on an average, I attend 3 or 4 webinars a day in which this is discussed. So frankly, this is outside the scope of my class. It's also outside the scope of any individual school management at present. The reason being, the policies that are coming out in a short-term manner from this thing. The policies are differing from government to government. And therefore, I think it is premature at this stage to really see where this will go. But what I can suggest to you is this, that as time goes by, the best investment the country can make in the future is in 3 areas. Technology is obvious. Healthcare is needed if you're not the use of anything else. And the third thing is education. Because, as I said, data is the new medium of driving the economy. Those who are educated and those who are not educated will become the rich and the poor. Therefore, educational investment in the long run is a huge requirement. Now, it is a matter of time before governments and individuals come to understand it. But let me also suggest to you one possibility, that there is going to be a shakeout. There's going to be a shakeout between those teachers who can adapt to the changes and those who don't. And therefore, the good teachers will be in greater demand, and many teachers who are not coping with the situation may actually find themselves out of work. But this is not the forum. This is not the forum for me to discuss government policy. We are saying, on the tours of an uncertain world, what kind of school leadership you should fight. And let me also highlight a point to all those who are attending this webinar. Please understand, all of us belong to, and the fact that we can attend this webinar means we belong to, an elite segment of Indian society. Most of the Indians are not in a position to attend this webinar. And therefore, if you throw up questions about how government should worry about how some in some rural area where there is no internet connectivity or electricity for that matter, then those are questions that we can't answer here. Let us set the pace by providing high quality school leadership amongst our schools, which then can be replicated, duplicated, because the government sees the merit of passing it on to the less privileged or in certain, you know, lesser endowed schools, as you rightly pointed out. Next, please.
Sir, there is a question. Online learning remain a larger necessity in the future. As school management, what steps need to be taken to ensure a seamless transition from home education? And what effects will it have on composition of staff and faculty, operationalization of schools, business models, etc.?
See, the first assumption is questionable, that this amounts to a transition to online learning. I think I mentioned somewhere when I spoke that we should see now a hybrid trend coming of some online learning and some physical contact learning. What shape that physical contact learning takes place, in the short run will look very disruptive, but in the long run we will find a solution. You saw in 9/11, people crashed planes into the World Trade Towers. Has that stopped air travel? In fact, the air travel business has boomed much more after that. Yes, certain protocols have changed at the airport, far more security, you have to remove your belt, you have to hand over your mobile, etc., etc. But you have adjusted to that. So this doomsday prediction that now it's all over and we switched over to online learning, as I said, this is crisis management. This is not long-term leadership solution. However, as I said, in the long run, schools have to change their models in which providing the can I be heard?
Yes.
Okay. So in the coming years, in the schools will have to provide a high level of bandwidth availability, access to devices to their teachers and students, whether it's at home or in the school, Now, whether you do it as in the form of bringing your own devices, whether the school provides devices, that's a matter of individual school's situation. It can also be some form of community devices. For example, where it is not so affordable, or sometimes it may happen that people who live in neighborhoods may have to come and share resources for the simple reason that in a house, let's say you have four gadgets, if you have four people, two adults and two children, and everyone wants to use the screen time for their own work. So there are challenges. The other thing is, please remember, online learning is not a phenomenon that happened with COVID-19. There are those MOOCs running a long time. Some of the world's best universities have been running online courses and offering it to them. Now, currently, many of them have made them free for the time being, but otherwise these paid courses or even free courses were running along. So there were many people who were adding to their qualifications and their capability and capacity building by subscribing to these courses and achieving this certification. So please don't take one thing and extrapolate it to impact the whole world. And secondly, pardon my saying, so many of you may not like it, we have this journalist kind of mentality. How will the children of migrant labor attend online classes? Now, this is not the forum that can discuss or solve that problem. But as I said, if we set up benchmarks of how we have transitioned into this post-COVID world or in an uncertain world, which has been happening all along, when television came, for a long time it was there. Then the personal computer came, it was there for a long time. Till the iPhone came. iPhone came in 2007. You're not talking about some ancient thing. Netflix has come how long back? A few years ago. And the whole business of how you watch how you watch television has changed. So things are changing and we are adapting to it. Nobody said, abhi Netflix aa gaya, the TV band ho jayega. So my sincere request, I'm sounding a bit big, but I attend webinars every day, and every day I hear this. As far as any good organization is concerned, it takes a long time to train staff. So to have layoffs and throw out teachers at random is a very foolish decision by any management, because there are no replacement teachers to bring. And if you bring a replacement teacher, it'll take you ages to train them. So please remember, there's a famous saying that if you don't invest heavily in a professional, then imagine how much you will invest if you get amateurs. So my sincere appeal to all the teachers who are competent and capable, please enhance your competencies, because you will be in very high demand. No good management will get rid of a good teacher, come what may. I can see Mr. Hore laughing. Don't you agree with me on this?
Absolutely. Completely agree with you. Absolutely.
Next question.
This is a good question. What should a principal do when the vision of the school is not in conformity with the vision of the school management?
When the vision of the school?
The school is not in conformity with the vision of the school management.
No. So how can the school vision differ from the vision of the school management?
I don't know.
Can I just clarify? I think sir heard it. Basically, she's saying that as a principal, I have different core values or different principles versus what, say, the school management believes in. So how do you kind of...
There are two ways. One is that you persuade the school management to come into alignment with your vision, which is highly possible if you can explain it in a rational way. In my own school, when I came, after I understood my idea of what needs to be done, I presented a 10-year vision plan, which the management, after discussion, accepted. And that is what we are running. But I didn't change the vision of the school. See, so one is that you try and persuade the management logically and to explain to them why your vision is the better one to buy. And if you still fail to do so, then I'm afraid if you're a principal worth your salt, you must step out. You cannot run a school which does not conform to the vision of the management. It's the management school. So if you feel so strongly that you cannot pursue your ideas, then you must need to go and work with some other management. But really, the first step is, if you're working hard, to bring management in line with what you think is the vision, and the management will adapt.
Yes.
Because most of them don't want to get in, the sensible managements don't want to get involved with the nitty-gritty of day-to-day functioning of the school.
Correct.
So you are like a CEO. A charter, and then they will assess you based on your delivery. Next,
next question is, what kind of education will be offered to the schools in the rural or semi-urban areas? Most schools do not have the option to go online with free education. What will the principals of such school do to impart education to masses?
Yeah, again, like I said, again, not strictly in the charter of this, but please understand what is semi-rural and rural today. The penetration of broadband through the country is increasing at a very rapid rate. You may be aware that recently Reliance and Facebook have signed up a big to benefit, in their estimate, 60 million small businesses and customers all around the country. If Facebook and Reliance Jio reach the smallest towns for the reasons of business, then obviously the internet has reached, right? And when the internet is reached, there cannot be, even today, are all the schools in, say, urban areas in Bombay, for example, identical? No. Are they offering the same product? No. Are they having the same pricing for fees? No. So the same way in rural areas, depending upon the initiative taken by individuals, by governments, by local municipality, definitely there will be a democratization of information and access to the internet. So the information available on, when I Google something from Jumri Talaya, I get the same as I get from Bombay. No difference. What I make of it, and that is where the challenge will come, where will they have adequate number of teachers to be able to articulate to the students what the meaning of this information is? That will remain a challenge. And this challenge is not restricted to rural areas. Please believe me, this is restricted to the biggest cities also. To get adequate number of high quality teachers continues to be a challenge. And our teacher training programs, our curriculum for teacher training programs are way behind the needs of the time. So which is, I'm emphasizing, those teachers who are already here and experienced, please develop capacities further. You are a rare and valuable asset in the times to come. Nobody is going to chuck you out from anywhere.
The next question, General, is how do we balance and assess the quantity and quality on online teaching session platforms?
Yes, I know there was a time when we were telling our children, no screen time. And now we're suddenly saying, come on. Where are you? I don't see you. You're not coming online.
Exactly.
So now, for example, those of us who have been working in offices, or those who work in technology companies, who work off their laptops or almost continuously, are also facing this problem. Whether it is carpal tunnel syndrome, whether it is problems with your eyesight. Therefore, right, as I said, after 9/11, there were changed protocols. There will have to be changed protocol. One on the cumulative time that you allow on screen, and one is the continuous time that you allow on screen. You understand? There may be a need to have forced breaks. So if your class break is after 30-35 minutes, or to have break, if you're actually online, maybe in 20 minutes. Right? Or give a hybrid set of activities that, right, they're online. Then you say, okay, guys, now you write down the following thing in the next 10 minutes, and then, you know, from a CAM scanner or something, upload it, and then we'll discuss this. Because sustained use of screen time is known to be harmful. There is no two ways about it. There is no magical formula for this. But please remember that I know today the biggest companies in the world don't manufacture anything, whether it's Facebook, Amazon, or Uber, or whatever. They're all using technology to drive business. But for most of us, even in the years to come, and in a high population country like India, there will have to be physical jobs that we do. And therefore, we have to be in touch with the physical world. So, for example, let us say tomorrow, healthcare will be a big thing. So, a nurse can't only do online work. A nurse must go and practice at the hospital. A doctor must go and practice with the patients. Mm-hmm. So, therefore, in education, the same philosophy will apply. The need for exchange learning will not go down. If travel is restricted, you can do a virtual tour of the Louvre Museum in Paris today. But if tomorrow travel opens up again, definitely, and if you can afford it and you can manage it, you must go and visit the museum physically. Because when you stand in front of the Mona Lisa, it's not the same as seeing a picture on the screen. So, on one hand, screen time will definitely rise vis-a-vis what it was before. Continuous time of at one go to be put is very important. Even otherwise, physically, for those of us who have desk-bound jobs or who sit on chairs, doctors will tell you in about 20 minutes, please get up and move around. Otherwise, the circulation of your body will be harmed. So similarly, protocols evolved by the scientists and qualified people to advise us as to in what combination of time and attention can we give to the online platforms of tomorrow.
The next question is quite a common question. I think a number of educators have the same query. How can assessments be taken while teaching?
At the early stages of the COVID-19 story, my first question to all educators is, why do we need an assessment at all? If you are putting the joy of learning into the student, and I keep telling staff, I said your best feedback that you can get is if the student tells his parents or mom, I'm looking forward to so-and-so teacher's class tomorrow. That is the highest form of feedback you can get. Why is assessment so important? Why is grading and rating so important? Now, yes, at a certain, now what happened? When suddenly COVID came in and those schools who could not finish exams, what did they do? They just promoted everybody to the next class and you started teaching online of the next class. Aren't most of the schools doing that today? What happened to this assessment suddenly? And that too to the end of the academic year. And yet you allowed it to pass. So therefore this obsession with assessment, with grades, I have parents asking, sir, fir wo class price ka kya hoga, subject price ka kya hoga? At this time, at the beginning of COVID-19, de-stressing the environment for the teacher, for the parent, for the student is the single biggest requirement, right? And therefore, you have tests, you have exams. There are many tools by which you can conduct online. After all, doesn't the IIT conduct the exam online? Where's the problem? It's the nature of the question that will have to change. Somebody asked me, somebody was anxious. He said, what if they, you know, what they are calling seemingly use unfair means. I said, why is it unfair? Today, when you are asked a question, don't you Google for the answer? Is that cheating? No, that's seeking information. It's how you frame the question and how you modify your assessment system to adapt to online thing is really how it is. How are SAT exams and other exams conducted? Aren't they conducted online? Where's the problem? But we have to adapt the way in which we conduct the assessment. We are wanting the same assessment to be put out in the same way, want to correct in the same manner, and we expect the students to use the current technology and behave as if they're from 40 years ago. No. And I think let us get this assessment obsession out of our way. If your child is learning, let me tell you, at the end of you finish your class today and you take your class tomorrow morning and you take a 5-minute quiz, and you will have a rough idea as to whether your kid is attentive, has he comprehended, or do you need to have some intervention. 5 minutes it takes, that's all. And today, there are so many tools online in which you can take an instant test. Even as adults, don't we do surveys? Don't you have Mentimeters and Google Forms? And haven't we adapted? We have all adapted. Today, I'll tell you, our teachers are being supplied their necessities at home because of their locked campus. So what does an administrator do? He puts out a Google form and they fill up what all the items they need. He compiles it, they arrange it from outside and put it in-house. All right. So my point is, please, my dear teachers, get this assessment thing out of till September, August, or whichever date. Free the teacher, free the parent, and free the child from the stress of being assessed. Try and shift the focus to enjoying online learning. This is a new experience for everyone. Mr. Ore, you are muted.
But someone has asked, doesn't assessment lead to standardization and setting grade level benchmarks?
Yes, it does. That's precisely the point. You are talking about, when I go and attend seminars, I hear a lot about personalized learning. Mm-hmm. Right? And then you come about with standardization. How do the two go together? So there is a phrase we use quite regularly. Our job is to set standards, not standardization. If every individual child has to flourish and grow to be what he or she has to be, then we have to set the standards. Similarly, for teachers, you have to set the capacity levels that they must achieve, and not standardization. If every teacher of mine has an identical PowerPoint with the same background, the same font, I mean, you say there's great standardization in my school. Is that what I want? So therefore, the focus now should be on standards and not standardization. Standardized tests are there as qualifying benchmarks, not achievement benchmarks. Excellence cannot be standardized. But you can say, if you get so much grades, you get 33% marks, you can pass. Or if you can jump 3 feet high, take you in the athletics for training. Those can be qualifying standards. There cannot be achievement standards. So therefore, try and set standards in this time when you have this online opportunity. This is a rarely it happens that the parents and teachers work together with the children. Use this chance to try and set up a culture of setting up standards which are unique to that particular child. And when school reopens and they come back to school, you can go back to your conducting standardization things to see that has anybody left behind, and do you need to have remedial classes or special interventions for certain type of children? No problem. But the timing is wrong to do it now. Yes.
I agree that. Should we take a couple of questions more? There's a question. Character building is highly required in today's generation. Please suggest some way it can be done in the current scenario.
Yes, I fully agree with this question that character building is most important, because what stands out in the long run is character. Because when there is pressure on you, when things are going wrong, like it happened in COVID, the way leaders at different places have responded has been a reflection of their character. And I think we have seen on TV examples worldwide, and I'm happy to say that in many number of countries which are being led by women, actually their responses have been more practical, more timely, and more effective. So character building, now is the time. Please understand that after the child finishes school and moves on, the impact of that character is not felt in the school, but the impact of a good or bad character is felt in the family or in the business or in the profession forever and ever. Therefore, the stakeholders in ensuring character building is happening successfully are the parents. And as I said, now is the time when we are partnering with the parents when their boys and girls are at home. This is the time at which we must set out small exercises in conjunction with parents, for them, not by us by giving answers, but by posing moral dilemmas to the parents and asking them to debate it with their children in their families. Because please understand, There are no rights and wrongs. In a Jain family, eating mutton may be a wrong thing to do. In another place, it may be a perfectly acceptable diet form. So therefore, our character building and ethics and values must go hand in hand. And what we need to highlight is what is appropriate, what is inappropriate, what is the way in which we should deal with people. And for this, there is a need to put students through certain dilemmas. When things are crystal clear, there is no problem. For example, if you are being, let us say you are having an assessment or a test, throw this dilemma open to parents to discuss with their children that should you answer your question paper honestly and ethically, or would you indulge in any wrongdoing? And let me tell you, it's my firm belief that the day a sense of self-responsibility helps, then that particular child character will show positive results. And the real test of character is what they do when nobody's observing them. If their parent is standing in front of them and they're answering online, obviously they're not going to be cheating. But the real test is parents say, okay, I'm off. You answer your paper 1 hour, 3 hours, whatever you have. Keep it in the right way. Not by just telling them, but by having debate and discuss what are the merits, demerits of using fair means, unfair means. Would they allow it to happen tomorrow in their business if one of their managers were to do it? If they were to be a teacher, would they allow it to happen in their class? If it's a matter of showing disrespect to elders, would they like the same to be shown to them? I mean, we are going to, during this lockdown period, conduct a large number of these series with our parents, but in which we are not going to give answers, but we are going to throw up these dilemma questions and allow them to debate it within their families and allow the children, most important, to find the right path. And you will find that exercise in character building will hold them for a lifetime. Next, please.
There's a question. How can we support parents? A lot is being done to support teachers and to adapt them. However, parents are still feeling anxious and are not always able to adapt the new changes.
Yes. So the tools and protocols of online learning need to be explained to the parents as well. Not only the tools, but the protocols as well. How is an online class to be conducted? In what manner should the student attend it? In what manner should they respond? When are you allowed to speak up? When are you allowed to do whatever you are? Similarly, parents need to know, for example, that let's say, suppose you decide to give an exam in which written, because the final board exams and others, even today in India, will continue to be handwritten. Therefore, while you're doing online classes, if you do assessments, especially in senior classes, you need to make them write it down. Now, having written it down, then you scan it and send it back to the teacher immediately after the exam. So, for example, depending on, you know, if you have apps like CAM scanner and all, parents must be also taught, and you need to verify with them, they understand what is the use of a CAM scanner. Otherwise, let us say there is a renegade child who says, I don't know how to do it because he not answered the paper properly, not answered it fully. He'll tell the mother, Mama, I don't know how to send this online thing. And the parent will say, sorry, our son couldn't send it because he didn't understand the protocol. So you have to anticipate these things, and the parents have to be educated. And even otherwise, in today's times, most parents studied in a different environment. Most parents have grown up in a different environment. These rapid changes and the impact of technology is not readily understood by them. They read a few things on the internet and they think they're experts in parenting. Schools, not because of COVID-19, but even otherwise, need to interact and educate parents on the direction education is taking in the years to come. And therefore, we have a saying, our orientation with our parents, that you are not just paymasters, you are our partners in this exercise. So if we treat parents as partners and not as paymasters, I think we will make better progress. Yeah, next please.
Thank you. So I think so. This was the. These are the questions. I don't find any other questions. People are really privileged to hear, or I mean, your perception, and they. It seems so. All of them really, really liked it. I don't see any questions. I don't know if there is any question from Facebook that has come up at all or not. I don't find any other questions. Just a minute. So I think so I need to call Surabhi to speak just now. All those people, all those teachers who have registered, yes, the program has been, the complete discussion has been recorded, and we will be sending you the, it will be converted to a YouTube link, and we will be sending it to all of you. We are also putting up a Google form. So it will be really, really good if you could kindly fill up the form, and it will help us to understand what are the things that you all really liked from the whole discussion that has happened so far. I don't know. I think so. Surabhi has been logged off. Thank you, Colonel General Kulkarni. Thanks a lot for the wonderful discussion that we had this evening. And we are really, really looking forward to have some more in future also. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.